Hello and welcome to Sunshine for Your Life. We've all had times when we have been spared from a calamity, an accident that we almost got into, but God spared us from it. I've seen that happen dozens of times in my life, and it's been very helpful to me. And sometimes we have accidents or we get close calls or something happens and we nearly back into somebody or something happens, and we've been spared from all of that. Well, a few years ago, I was driving to the coast from this area. And I didn't know it, but a few cars back from me, the driver of a van was high on drugs. He had stolen the van. He was high on drugs, and he was driving very erratically and recklessly, and the police were chasing him. The van had been reported missing, and he was smashing cars as he drove. So I could hear the smashing of the cars behind me, and I'm saying, oh, there must have been an accident or something. And he was just going from one car to another and smashing into it, but he was high on drugs. And so when he got to my car, he decided not to smash into me, but he passed me on the left-hand side. He was like 2 inches from my car. And it was a hot day, my window was open, and if I'd had my hand out the window, which I had that previously, he would have broken my arm. It was that close. But I didn't. I pulled my arm in, which was fortunate. And he got by me, and he took a sharp left turn. We got to an intersection. He was now ahead of me, and he went to a left on an intersection, and he was going to go barreling forth. He was going quite a high rate of speed, and the police were right behind him. Well, instead of going forward, his car started driving sideways, and it jumped up a hole like a small hill and landed on somebody's lawn, and then went forward and smashed into a tree. Now, I considered this to be somewhat of a miracle, because had he gone straight, either direction or after he'd taken that turn, he would have hit somebody and there would have been some serious injuries, or somebody might have even been killed. But I saw it happen. He went to the left, and then suddenly the car just went sideways up a small hill on somebody's lawn. I'm sure he didn't steer it that way. And then it smashed into a tree. He managed to take out a utility pole. A transmitter went dead. Everything went dark. But everybody was safe. I thought he was going to be killed when anybody got out of his car, which was stolen, his van, which was stolen, and he started running, and the police finally caught up with him. And the fact that he went sideways was a help to them as well as to cars on the road, so that no one was hurt. So how do you know that God is there? You know God is there with you by the scriptures and also by your personal experiences. God has proven his faithfulness to us time and time again as we are spared. And he did the same thing for his people in the Old Testament time. Now I want to talk a little bit about Elisha. There were two prophets. One was Elijah and the other was Elisha. I'm going to talk about the second one, Elisha, in the Old Testament. He's a good example of how God protected him because he was a prophet. He came after Elijah. He did twice as many miracles as Elijah did, but they were intimately very well connected because he was a student of Elijah. So I want to take a look at him, and he is a prophet, remember, in Jewish history, and his name was Elijah, and he protected his king, and he protected his nation against an enemy, because God always told him what was going on, where to go, and what to do. So the enemy, Syria, decided, since they couldn't win any battles because he always knew where they were and he was always winning against them, they decided to capture him. And one day, Elijah's servant saw the enemy all around the mountains, and they were out to capture and probably kill Elijah, and the servant panicked. And he asked Elijah, "What shall we do?" And in the King James, it's translated, "What, my master, shall we do?" He was frightened because he saw all the enemy, the horses, the chariots, you know, ready to descend and capture Elijah. Well, Elijah knew that he was specially protected. And so Elijah told him, "Don't be afraid." And he prayed and he asked God to show him the marvelous entourage that was God's entourage that was to protect him. And so what he actually told his servant was, "Don't be worried. There are more with us than with them." And then he prayed God would open the eyes of his servant so his servant could see all of the heavenly hosts that were there that would protect him. And God answered, and the servant saw God's army, horses and chariots of fire all around the mountain. There is no way that the enemy could capture Elijah. God always knew what was happening to Elijah, and he always revealed to Elijah what he needed to know. And Elijah always knew that there was an unseen army, God's army, that was protecting him. And this is the thing I really want to point out in this sermon. It's important. God always knows what's going on with you, and he always knows how best to protect you, and he will always reveal to you what you need to know and what you need to do. You are never left unprotected. God has knowledge of all situations. He has knowledge of all crises, and he revealed to Elijah what he needed to know and what he needed to do and where he needed to go, and all within the time that was needed. God is not surprised by anything that happens to you. God already knows what's going to happen to you because he has all knowledge, and he knows what's going to happen to you every single day, from the day that you were born through the day that you're going to pass on. He knows it all. There's no such thing as God not knowing. He knows everything. This knowledge can give us faith, and it can be applied for our own lives, because God knows what your personal situation is. If you have a difficult personal situation, God already knows what it is, and he knows more about it than you do. We think that we know what our situations are. We think we know what we're struggling with. We think we know what we have to do. We try to do it in such a way that we can get out of it or work with it or solve it or something. But God has the intimate knowledge of how far it extends and how it's going to affect us and how best to protect us and how best to walk us through it. And if we have the faith that God will do that for us as we pray about it, God will do that for us. God will reveal to you what you need to know about your situation at the time that you need to know it. When something happens, I know I've worked with ministries before, and I've worked with people who would want to have shut us down in our ministries, and I've always found out just in time what was going on and always been given direction as to where to go and what to do to preserve us. And this happened over and over and over again, and anybody who's involved in a Christian ministry will tell you the same thing. And you can also recognize that God is continually protecting you. You're not doing this alone. He is with you to protect you at all times. So we can confidently say that God knows, and God reveals, and God protects. In our daily lives, we experience things that are fearful. Even in the news, things are fearful. There's violence and shootings and death every day. And especially now that there's so much gun violence and shooting and mass shootings at different places, concerts, stores, even in the parking lots of stores. And there's death, and there's also weather calamities. We're seeing a terrible change in the weather patterns. The weather patterns are much worse and much more difficult than they ever used to be. And it's enough to make you afraid. And our fear is complicated, though, because our imagination takes wings, and we imagine things sometimes far worse than they are. And we also misinterpret things. So we sometimes have a lot of fear in our lives. Without realizing it, we're harboring all of that fear. And we need to realize that the fear isn't necessary, because God is already already in touch with everything that we are in touch with. We don't have to worry about it. And fear sometimes will take on a life of its own, and it becomes very difficult. Yet the scriptures give us hope. We don't have to worry because scriptures themselves will give us hope. And the first scripture on the screen is going to be Philippians 4, 6, and 7. So I'm going to just run one line or two and then read the whole thing. So Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Let me read it again. That's not the whole thing, but let me read it again, and then I'll continue and read all of it. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Now, what that is saying is don't be afraid of anything, but in every situation, by prayer and supplication, in other words, you're praying about the situation, you're making your request to God, let your requests be made known to God. Now, I'm going to go back and read the whole thing, including what is not on the screen. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind through Christ Jesus. That's the whole thing. So from letting your request be made known to God, then the peace of God is going to guard your heart, which is going to be your emotions, and your mind, which is going to be your thinking process. And it's the peace that passes all understanding. Now, Christians who have had this peace say it's a much deeper peace than just feeling peaceful. It's like you can't worry because the peace is so great that there is no fear. It like eradicates fear. So by prayer and be making your request known to God, and then God gives you the peace, which is going to calm your mind, it's going to calm your soul, it's going to calm your emotions, and it's going to guard you. And through Jesus Christ, the Bible says that. It's one of the most popular and the most relied on scriptures in the Bible because it says it all. You talk to God, you get in prayer, you give him your request, you talk about the situation as best as you understand it, knowing full well that he understands it all. Nothing takes him by surprise, and then he showers you with a peace. And this peace guards the way that you think, and it guards your emotions, and then the answers come because God is in it. And this peace is through Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So it guards your hearts and your minds and your thinking and your emotions. And that's important to realize. Now, this is what the verse says. So if I'm to paraphrase this, and it's going to sound a little wordy here, but if I'm to paraphrase this, it's going to say, don't be afraid. Pray about everything with thanksgiving. Make your requests known to God. And then the peace of God, which is greater than you can understand, greater than you can imagine, even though you're feeling it, it's greater than you can even imagine, will guard your emotions and guard your thinking, and you will feel much better, and he answers your prayer. It means that God knows everything about you. He knows what's happening to you moment by moment. He is not surprised. I mean, I've been through storms, terrible storms when I've been driving. I've been through downline bursts that were thought maybe to be mini tornadoes, and I've been through snowstorms in which the road was perfectly clear ahead of me, but nowhere else. So my car drove through dry land and dry road, even as the snow was piling up on either side of the car. And it's just God's way of taking care of us. He's going to guide you. And we also have an unseen army. Elisha knew about this unseen army to the point where he asked God to show it to his servant when his servant was afraid. And God did that. But he knew it was there. He didn't have to see it to know it was there. His servant needed to see it because his servant was afraid and didn't realize the army, the unseen heavenly army that was around him. Well, we all have angels around us. I do believe in the ministry of angels. The Bible talks about it. The angels are sent to minister for those who shall be heirs of salvation. That's another verse. I don't have it in the sermon, but it's another verse in the scriptures that the angels of God have come to minister for those who shall be heirs of salvation. Well, who are the heirs of salvation? It's the Christians. He's guarding the Christians. So no matter what happens to you, God is going to see it all, and he is going to work with it. Now, Elisha was not afraid, and I would expect that when he honored his request that his servant see the heavenly army, that his servant was no longer afraid either. It comes down to a matter of trust. You can trust God, and you must trust God to have peace of mind. And trust is a decision. I might not see everything that's going to happen to me here and in the future, but I have to have trust. Trust is my decision. I decide to trust God because I know he's going to take care of it, and he always has taken care of it. So therefore, he is steadfast, and he is honorable, and he is true to his word, and he will take care of things, and you can make that decision to trust. Now, the second verse on the screen is going to be John 14:27, and this is what it says. And here again, I just have part of it on the screen, and then I'll read the rest of it. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Let me read the whole thing now, starting with what's on the screen. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So what is he saying? I'm going to give you peace, not like the world gives it. This peace does not come from a tranquilizer. It doesn't come from meditation. It doesn't come from biofeedback. I am giving you my peace, and it's not the same as the world gives. It's much deeper than what the world gives. So you don't have to let your heart be troubled. You don't have to let it be afraid. In other words, you have a choice. If you trust God, your fear is not going to be as great as if you don't trust God. And we are, as I said in other verses at other times, that we are guarded, and we can have peace because God gives it to us. Now, and I'm going to close with a final Bible verse, and it's Psalm 32:8, and this is what it says. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. Then let me finish it, because it's a little longer than that, but not much longer. It says, I will instruct and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you. There's another version of it that says, I will counsel you and I will watch your progress. The same thing as watching over you. So you can make the decision to trust, because he knows everything anyway. And there's no reason why you shouldn't trust him, because he's trustworthy. He watches you. He has millions and millions of thought as the grains of sand, as I said in the previous sermon, about you every second. Every second he's thinking about you. He has good plans for you, as Jeremiah 29:11 says, which I gave in the last sermon. You know, my plans for you are for good and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. He's involved intimately, if you're a Christian, in all of your affairs. He will bring you to a peace where your mind and your heart will have peace. All you have to do is to make that decision to trust, because this is what is your responsibility, to trust the great God that will take care of you. So I'll close it here. We'll be doing something else next time. Please join me then.